So the subject of tonight is very important. Forgiveness is something that we all should learn a little bit, because we will have, or we already did, practice some kind of forgiveness. So let's start with this very powerful video, and then I will talk a little bit about it.
I wish for him to have a long, suffering, cruel death.
He's gonna go to hell, and that's where he belongs.
But then the emotionless facade finally cracked when the father of one of his victims appeared to surprise him with a dose of human kindness.
Mr. Ridgway, there are people here that hate you. I'm not one of them. You've made it difficult to live up to what I believe, and it is what God says to do, and that's to forgive. You are forgiven, sir.
So this is just a little tiny video that I wanted to start the presentation, because this man, he was a serial killer. He killed many women, and he was very famous for being very cold, even when he gave interviews about why he did and why he was still trying to do it. But here shows you that he was so used to the feeling of hatred, because he did it, so it was almost like he was pursuing to receive it back all the time. So every time another person went there and said he deserves to die, he deserves to go to jail forever, this was normal, this was natural for him. So this was nothing. He was cold-faced looking at the person. But in the moment, one person, the father of one of the victims, went there and said, I forgive you. He couldn't believe it. He was shocked, because this was not what he was normally used to. So this is what we have to understand, that sometimes one word, one gest can really change the whole structure of a human being that's mentally perturbed. So now, you're gonna see another one that is also powerful.
A powerful moment in a Big Island court today, an admission of guilt and an act of forgiveness stunned those in the courtroom today. And through it all, a resolve to share the story of the high price of drunken driving. KITV4's Catherine Cruz has more.
A shattered windshield and shattered lives. That was the work of a drunk driver. Little Aaliyah, who was barely a year and a half old, died that day, her mother disfigured. The child's father stood outside the Kona court with his baby girl's blanket on his shoulder.
Her scent is gone. Can't smell her anymore. She's gone.
His pain spilled over inside the courtroom as the woman who took the little girl's life apologized. Valerine Kilhano Niddle was so drunk she blanked out speeding through an intersection. She said she is not the same person she was that day in May of last year. She promised to commit her life to keeping others from making her mistake of drinking too much and getting behind the wheel of a car.
I have to work tirelessly to keep drunk drivers off the road.
Afterwards, the judge remarked that she had just witnessed the most extraordinary acts of compassion and contrition, yet had to consider that Kaleo Hanum-Niddle had a prior DUI conviction.
I was killed. The mother permanently disfigured and dreams of a family quashed. And a community left in horror.
Kaleo Hanum-Niddle's blood alcohol level was 3 times over the legal limit. She was sentenced to a 10-year prison term. Outside the court, representatives of MAD had this to say.
There are no winners when it comes to drunk driving. Today, I mean, the justice has been served.
In offering his forgiveness, Wayne Braden believes that Kaleo Hanum-Niddle was a decent woman who made a terrible mistake. He vows to push for tougher drunk driving laws, saying alcohol detecting devices in cars can't come soon enough. Catherine Cruz, KITV4 News.
Kaleo Hanum-Niddle originally asked for a month to get her affairs in order before beginning her prison sentence, but a judge took her into custody immediately to start serving 10 years behind bars.
So can somebody turn on the light? So in this second video, you saw this amazing gesture of forgiveness. How many of us would be able to do this? How many of us would be able to really go and hug this person who just killed our daughter and disfigured our husband? This is so difficult, but you can see it's possible. So we are here not to say that we are getting out of here and forgiving every single person at the same moment, but we are here to learn how to start doing it, because sometimes it is a process. And sometimes, depending on what was the issue, it's a long process. So to start this process, nobody better than Jesus to help us to understand. So Jesus, the biggest psychotherapeutic doctor of earth. So anybody would like to read? Volunteers, please.
Jesus, the biggest psychotherapeutic doctor of earth. Jesus was teaching in the temple when the scribes and Pharisees brought to him an adulterous woman, and they asked him if she should be stoned as required by the law of Moses.
So just to start here, the scribes in the time, they were the lawyers, and the Pharisees, they were the politicians, but also they were the head of their religious tribes. So they were really the whole power. And when they brought this adulterous woman to Jesus, they were not asking for help and how to really resolve that issue. No, they were really trying to trap Jesus, because in their mind, in their disturbed mind, they're like, now we are gonna find a way to put this man in jail or to kill him. Because if Jesus said, please forgive her and let her go, he was going against the law of Moses. So immediately, jail or killing. If Jesus said, okay, she has to go to jail, he's going against his own law of forgiving, letting go. And if Jesus didn't say anything, oh, he's being omissive. He's not mentioning anything. And then Jesus, that was much smarter than them, answered. Any volunteer?
Jesus answered, if any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. John 8, chapter 1, I don't know,
11. Jade 8, 1, 11 is fine. So his answer was very smart, because who is the person who has no sin? Nothing. Who is the perfect being? Nobody. What happened is that we hide, so people cannot find it. That's what happened. But you cannot hide forever. And then the accusers slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest, until only Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with the woman. Jesus asked her, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. So let's start here, beginning with the oldest. Emmanuel, through the mediumship of Chico Xavier, talks about this passage, and he said, when Jesus said that, they start going towards Jesus because he was on the floor writing. He was like, not disturbed at all. He answered and continued writing on the sand. And then they start going close to Jesus and looking. And then the oldest start going to complain more because he had more power. And then Jesus immediately started writing his sin. So each one of them went there to complain and look what Jesus was writing. He was writing murder, betrayer, and they were being shocked, because how can I say something? Because these men already know. And why the oldest? Also, because when we are older, we have more time on earth and we have more time to commit mistakes. Thankfully, we don't just do mistakes. We do a lot of good things too. But unfortunately, when we are older, we really have a lot of time to commit a lot of bad mistakes. Another thing important here, when Jesus tell her, neither do I, go and sin no more. He didn't condemn her, but he told her, sin no more, meaning do not repeat, do not commit the same mistake. Wake up. Why so many times we are we overcome some very big problem, a friend forgive us, and later on, we do the same thing with another person. Why we keep doing this? We have to remember, we were forgiven once. It doesn't mean that we're gonna be forgiven 1,000 times by that person. We really have to wake up and better ourselves. It's very important that we do that. And here, this is a book, The Greatest Psychologist Who Ever Lived. It was written by Dr. Mark Baker. He's also a psychologist. And he studied the whole Bible in order to be able to write this book. And you can see and you can hear his whole interview in Kardec Radio. Dr. Vanessa Anceloni interviewed him. He's a remarkable person. So if you cannot buy the book, at least hear this, his interview with Dr. Vanessa Anceloni. And here we are going to see some very important quotes. I separated some of them. Volunteers?
Luke 6:37. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven.
So this is wonderful. This is wonderful for all of us. But do we know how not to judge? We are always judging. It's like a natural thing of us to judge. We judge all the time. So we, especially when it's not a friend or it's not our family member, all we judge is easier. Oh, look at him. You see what he did? But look at our hand. We point one finger. We have three fingers coming back to us and one going up and boom. This is what? This is bad energy. We are sending that bad vibration. That person maybe is not sending back, but the environment, the whole universe is sending back to us. It's the law of action and reaction. Whatever we do, will come back. So it's so much better we do something good because we receive something good. So next time you guys are gonna point fingers, remember, try not to do it. Next. You guys are too shy today. Yes.
Matthew 5:22-24. So if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come to and offer your gift.
This here you can compare. You can compare to a person, for example, is in a deathbed and is gonna discarnate soon. So when we are in situations like that, we start really thinking about our past, all the good things we did, all the horrible things we did, all the things we really didn't like, but it passed and then we didn't think anymore. But then Jesus said, go back, reconcile with your friend, ask for forgiveness. Because when we discarnate and we lose this body here, it will be so much more painful because then we don't have a body to fall asleep and forget everything. You are awake 24 hours and your conscience is spread and then you think all the time about the bad, usually you think more about the bad things you did and you feel a horrible remorse. So stop it. Don't wait to be in a deathbed to do it. Go now, go tomorrow. Call your mother. I'm sorry. And you know, I always say that. Doesn't matter if the person is not gonna forgive you. You are doing the act. So you are almost forgiving yourself. Doesn't matter what will be the reaction of the other person. We have to take the first action. Next.
23:34. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do.
So this was the last sentence of Jesus when he was really in the moments of death. And you see how amazing he is. All the horrible things that we did, yes, we did, because we are reincarnated souls. We are reincarnated bodies, and we lived in that time. So we did that, and immediately he forgave us. And he was still begging God to forgive all of us. So if he did that, why can't we do a little bit, a little thing? He forgave the most, we can do a little bit too. And now I have other sentences by people that I really admire.
We must develop and maintain the capacity to forgive. He who is devoid of the power to forgive is devoid of the power to love. There is some good in the worst of us, and some evil in the best of us. When we discover this, we are less prone to hate our enemies. Martin Luther King, Jr.
So Martin Luther King was an amazing human being. Until the 1960s, I believe 68, here in the United States, blacks and whites, or Latinos and whites, they could not sit together in the same bus. Can you imagine this? We're in 2013, this was 1968. And in the South, in some parts of the South, it was even further. So this human being, he saw that there was always something good, even in where it was totally bad. So when we think about that little symbol of yin and yang, you know, it's like a round little thing that there is a part that's white with a black dot, and there is a part that's black with a white dot. So what is that symbol? The black is like the darkness, but every darkness, there's a little white dot of a purity. But what happened to that darkness? It's so much darkness, it's almost like the person really didn't try to work on in this goodness that he, she had in themselves. But the spirits always tell us that the worst of the criminals, whenever a mother, a loving person, doesn't need to be a mother, but usually it's the mother who really touched the person, comes and really offers some help, usually when they are discarnated, that's the only way to make them to wake up. And then they cry. Then they feel sorry for all the horrible things they did. And the white part. The white part has a little dot of black. Yes, but what happened there? There is a very good person who learned how to control the evil instincts that we all have. So this person, yes, is much more evolved because this person already overcome so many things that we are still working on. So next one.
The weak can never forgive. Forgiveness is the attribute of the strong.
This is absolutely true, but society do not understand that. Society thinks the weak, who cares about them? If you are strong, you really have to be powerful, you have to fight, you have to smack the other. That's what society portrays to us. But we really understand the strong person is the person who was hurt so badly and it still goes to you and say, it's okay, I forgive you. Sometimes the other person will say, why? I'm not asking for forgiveness. But then shows you how the person is powerful. The person overcome that pain and went towards the person who really hurt, and the person told him, I forgive you. And the last one I love, always forgive your enemies. Nothing annoys them so much. Oscar Wilde. This is wonderful. I have a very funny story, and I have to be quick because I have so many stories, but I had a boyfriend, super extremely jealous boyfriend. I was always like this, super talkative. I talked to everybody, so it was awful relationship. And one day, he was 25, I decided to do a surprise party, and I got together with his brother and his mother. We called all his friends from the university, and we had like 20 guys. He was a mechanical engineer, so just guys, had no girls to call. So all the guys went to this restaurant, and then I invited all my girlfriends. We went there. So when we arrived, surprise! I was so happy. He looked at me. He wanted to kill me. I was like, I cannot believe it. His parents were there, his brothers, his sister. I was like, is this man crazy? And then I was smiling to everybody. But I was like, oh my God, what am I gonna do? And then the whole night was terrible because my friends couldn't understand why I was so stressed. His friends, each time they came to talk to me because I spoke to them on the phone, he wanted to kill me, so I was avoiding to talk to the friends. It was terrible. His parents bought this very big cake, delicious. We only ate like one third of it. So by the end of the night, everybody left. And I said, I wanted to kill him too, but I was like very sweet. Honey, let's take the cake home. I can keep it. And then he's like, rah, rah. So I took the cake, we went to the car, and I told him, please open the trunk. I had my super cute dress. Open the trunk. And he looked at me, I cannot put this cake in the trunk, it's gonna destroy my car. And I said, it's in the box. And then he's like, oh, you drive me crazy. Anyway, he put the cake in the trunk. If he was normal, he was gonna drive smoothly home, I would take the cake, and that's it. He took a highway at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he drove in zigzag, zoom, zoom, zoom. I was in the car just thinking, oh my God, that delicious cake is gone. Because he was gone from my life, but the cake, okay. I arrived at my apartment. I left saying goodbye forever, and I went to my door building, and there I was waiting for the elevator, and then the elevator is taking time. When I look, oh my God, he's right there with the cake all smushed, all destroyed, and he looked at me. Didn't you want the cake? Didn't you want the cake? And I look, I was like, oh, I was afraid of him. And then he said, take the cake. So he pushed the cake. And then I instantly grabbed the cake and like, oh my God. And I was totally dirty. What was my instinct? What do you think? What I wanted to do? In split second, I saw a movie of all these bad soap operas that people throw cakes in the face of each other, and then we fight, and the black. And then I thought, no, this cake is too delicious. I embraced the cake, went in the elevator and said, goodbye. The door closed, I went upstairs furious, but I had the cake. So what happened there? I really had an instinct of throwing this cake on his face to demonstrate how mad I was. But I have to tell you the truth. In that time, I was not so elevated, so I really thought about the cake. But nowadays, I would think, I'm not going to give back all this horrible energy he's giving to me. But okay, 1 minute passed. I'm in my house, putting the cake away, thinking, what am I going to do? Bling, 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 here, right there. And then I'm like, oh my God, what he wants to throw on me now? And then I'm like, I'm not gonna open the door. He's like, I'm sorry, I'm an animal. I'm like, oh. So if I really had thrown the cake there, he was not gonna have this reaction. Because the natural reaction was receive the cake back and fight and say horrible things. But because I didn't do that, he was so surprised. He couldn't believe. He was crying like a baby. Well, later I tell the rest of the story. So what happens after an offense? Look at this guy. What do you think he's going to do? He just poof. What? He's going to immediately forgive you? It's impossible. We are very surprised. We didn't expect it. So it is very natural to have our heart waves become small and fast. It's like boom. So your heart is like, I was hearing this interview about this doctor. He was explaining all the details of the physical body, so what happens to us. So he talks about the heart waves. So they get very small and very fast. Our heart is like gonna pump, 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 pump. So it is very normal to feel anger, revolt, to wish to attack because we have instinct of protection. So if we were attacked, we wanna do it again. We wanna give back. But we are not animals. We can control ourselves. We are not animals anymore. We evolved, thank God. So we don't need to do that. The problem is right here. After this, what are you going to choose? What are you going to pursue? Are you going to pursue hatred? Or are you going to pursue forgiveness? This is the main issue. A lot of people do not pursue forgiveness. They do not understand it. Or at least don't understand immediately. So he thinks, he did this horrible thing to me. He has to pay. That's the majority of society. But how to start forgiving? So to some people, it's very easy. It's natural. To others, it's very, very difficult, especially depending on what was it. Was just a slap on the face or you killed my husband? It's very different. So I have two quotes here for these two wonderful people that I love so much, Divaldo Franco and Raul Teixeira, and they basically say the exactly same thing. So Divaldo says, to forgive is not to forget, but it means to understand that the person who hurt you is wrong. Then he, she must be seen as a sick person. And then Raul says, to forgive is not to develop Alzheimer, but it is to understand why the person did it to me. So a lot of people say, I have to forget that, because if I forget this ever happened, I will forgive. No, it's not true. If your daughter was murdered, can you forget that you ever had a daughter? It's impossible. How are you gonna forget you had a daughter? Okay, maybe if he slapped to your face, you're gonna forget it ever happened, but to some things you can't. So you cannot develop Alzheimer. Raul Teixeira, he's extremely funny. I love his lectures, so he always makes some jokes. And yes, we cannot just try to develop Alzheimer for a situation. We have to work on the situation inside of ourselves. And there are many, many ways to do that. So I will try to talk a little bit. And here's the doctor that I read and I saw so many interviews, so many works that he did. So Dr. Fred Luskin, he's the director of Stanford Forgiveness Project of Villanova University in Pennsylvania. So he says, to forgive is to digest difficult situations in order to avoid developing certain diseases like reflux, gastroenteritis, and cancer. Yes, you know, when a person has the tendency of retaining inside all these negative feelings, all this pain, sometimes when talk about it, I can't even talk about this because I feel that pain. Yes, you are feeling it because you are cultivating it. You are keeping it inside of you. And if you keep it too much, danger. So we shouldn't keep it. We really have to get rid of it. So forgiveness is a process. Look how adorable. He's trying his best, you know. I'm sorry, but you know, it doesn't mean that she's gonna say, yeah, these cute flowers are gonna make me forgive you. But this is the first step. In her memory will be always that he tried. Maybe she didn't accept in that time, but he did try. So here are a bunch of things that we have to do in order to start this process. So, come on, volunteers.
Disconnect from the problem.
Next.
Find the place that help us. Understand that person is sick. Forgiveness will help me, not them. We are not perfect, so we need to forgive ourselves too.
Exactly. There are so many, more than 30, but I had no place to put them. So I have to work on the most important of them. So the last one, you see, disconnect from the problem, time is a blessing. Time is really a blessing. If something terrible happened to us today, maybe we cannot forgive tomorrow, next month, next year, maybe we will need a lot of time. But even this long time, we have to keep working it on us. Because if we decide not to do it, 20 years, 30 years, we will die and we are still having the problem. To understand the person is sick, so when we think that person is mentally sick, or the person was on drugs, or the person was drunk, we try to make this person less horrible. We try to give something to cause it. It helps us to forgive. And then forgiveness will help me, as I said, it will help us. And we are not perfect, so we need to forgive ourselves too. Sometimes we keep telling, oh, I try everything, I read 20 books of auto-help and I can't. Yes, sometimes we can't, but we have to try to forgive ourselves for not forgiving the other. And because of this, I have this very cute prayer. You see, he thinks he's the king, ha, no. We are the queens of the house. My husband always says that. He always says, yes, honey, is his last word. So this is a super cute prayer, the Spiritist's wife prayer. And then it goes, God, please give me wisdom to understand my husband, love to forgive his mistakes, patience to tolerate him, but don't give me strength or I will beat him up. So be it. And it is true. It is true. It is true. The important thing is if we have strength to dominate ourselves. We women are very strong. We have to dominate ourselves. Not even because of the physical power, but sometimes words are so powerful and they can kill a person with the bad energy that words transmit. So to continue here, not to return the same evil action. As I said with the cake, you know, as I did with the cake, do not give back the bad energy. So this was another sentence that my mother used to say all the time. I can give you a bull in order to not start a fight, but I will give a whole cattle to not get out of it. So when I was a child, I used to think, this is fantastic. My mother is super powerful. So I adapted and I created, I incorporated this sentence to my actions. And when you really think, this is awful. You know, if I do not start, I don't want to start a fight, but if I am in a fight, I have to fight forever. This is something a person that really didn't understand Spiritism, and not even Spiritism, didn't understand the message of Jesus. We really cannot accept that. But unfortunately, especially kids, they think it's wonderful. So this is something for us not to do. And the most important of all is having faith in God. Because when we have faith in God, we understand that something will change. Something will change in our lives to the betterment. So we can work this in the process of forgiveness too. So why we can't forgive? Even after all that, we still can't forgive. So we can't forgive because many times we think, oh, I don't have enemies. I don't have enemies, so I don't need to forgive anybody. Yes, we all have enemies. But you know, enemy is a very heavy word. Sometimes we have that people that we don't really deal very well. So that person we can call enemies. And I cannot absolve. So we think if we forgive, we are allowing that horrible thing to happen over and over. It's very different. We are not judges. God is the judge. And we can even say that God is the judge because our conscience is really the judge. So we can't really think about that. And then our pride, revenge, hatred, selfishness, these are just few of the feelings that make us not being able to forgive. So we have always to think about why I can't forgive. It's because I think I'm very special, so this cannot happen to me. It's because I really think I deserve all the better things in the world. It's because I really never liked that person, and now I hate revenge. I really want to destroy that man that did something to my car. This is something to meditation. And here, here you can see the spiritual influence on us. Here is a woman, she's sleeping, and here you can see an obsessor. So we all have good spirits and not that good spirits that are around us. We can say they are connected to us because what connects us is energy. So if our energy is dense, if we cultivate hatred, if we really love to gossip and say bad words and sometimes change a little bit in our way, we are creating this dark environment around us, this dark energy that will start attracting more and more spirits that feed in this dark energy. They enjoy it. So what happened to this woman? She feels very tired, she feels headaches, she feels horrible pains, and she feels all kinds of things that start happening because this heavy, dense energy starts connecting with her perispirit, and the consequences go to her physical body. So here in the back, you see probably her guardian angel and a team of enlightened spirits analyzing the situation and trying to see how to help both of them. Because when we talk about obsessors, oh, we think, oh, these evil spirits. No, they are just our brothers and sisters who made something wrong, like we did. We don't know what we did in the past incarnations. And sometimes we know, and that's even worse. So this is, and here you can see another person. she is connected. She's a spirit connected to her body by the silver cord. And she goes to the spiritual realm, and here are two spirits that are trying to attack her. But she is a person that really tries to better herself. She prays, she tries to do her best in the everyday life. So she is surrounded by so much love energy, and sometimes also energy from other people towards her, because she already did so much goodness to others, that their attacks cannot really interfere on her at all. So you can see how we can start protecting ourselves by the spiritual point of view. And this is another little movie of this person that I adore, that Archbishop Desmond Tutu. So please just turn off the light.
Despite all appearances to the contrary, it is a moral universe that, in the end, good prevails. Segregation was a key aspect of our lives. You knew, I mean, there were some who were in and the others were out. You had these separate exits, but then you went onto the same street and you breathed the same air. And it was crazy, but a lot of it was humiliating. You were human, but you were not quite as human as the others.
We say no to evil.
No to evil.
We say yes to goodness.
Yes.
Very many good things have happened. I mean, one is we're free. It was quite unbelievable how quickly it happened. I mean, it was, as they sometimes say, like Christ lightning. I mean, one day Nelson Mandela is in jail, the next is out, then you have negotiations, and hey presto, we have a democracy.
But I and the AMC, I as opposed to that nation, as we are to right of nation.
Imagine if we had chosen the path of retribution and revenge, our country would have been dust and ashes now. When you nurse a grudge, your blood pressure shoots up and you feel it in your tum-tum. Whereas when you forgive, your blood pressure goes down and you have a physical well-being that reflects your spiritual well-being. So that you can say, forgiving is good for your health.
So he is great. He's so positive. He's so happy, and he has all this joy. And you know, can you just imagine us living in that time? It was terrible. And they were able to forgive. Nelson Mandela also, all the people involved in it, so much pain. It's so easy to hate all the ones who did that. And as he said, they breathed the same air, they walked the same streets, but they couldn't go in the same door. They couldn't sit in the same chairs. It was just terrible. But if people can overcome situations like that and help a whole nation, you know, to change a movement that is so big, we can do our little part. The thing is, like, sometimes we are lazy and we just decide not to do next week, next month, next life. No, we can't do it next life. We have to do in this incarnation. Let's not postpone that much. We have the power to do it. So, do we have a desire to do justice or revenge? Because many times, oh, he has to go to jail because of this. Is it a desire of justice or revenge? Because it's very similar. If you analyze it, it can be very similar. So justice, the understanding that the person who committed an evil act should be brought to justice, charged for the crime, and then comprehend that what they did was wrong. So this is justice. This, you want that person who really did something horrible to understand you are there because you did this, this, and this. So now we see revenge. Revenge is the desire to return the evil received. The Hammurabi Code from the 1700s before Christ talks about the law of retaliation, where a person who suffered an evil action had the right to inflict the same or worse back. So eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth is actually much after, much, much after, like 500 years after. So before the Hammurabi Code was like, if you cut a finger, I can cut your whole arm. This is not a, what kind of a justice is that? This is not justice, this is revenge. This is really empowering your hatred. So we really, when we say certain things, we have to analyze ourselves deeply to understand if we want justice or if deep inside we want revenge. So Simon Peter asked Jesus, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? Seven times? And Jesus answered, I say not to you until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Jesus taught us to forgive always, always to forgive. And I have a story from Divaldo Franco that this woman came to him and told him, Divaldo, I already forgave my husband 505 times, so I cannot forgive anymore because it's only 70 times seven. And then he was like, Divaldo, no, I'm sorry, was Chico. And then Chico was like, what am I gonna answer? Like, she did what it's supposed to do. And then Joanna came and she said, Emmanuel, I'm mixing the both mediums. Emmanuel came and said, tell her for each sin. So it's forever, because she said the husband did so many things. The story is so beautiful, but I have no time to tell you the end of the story. So the law of cause and effect. Now another amazing person, Gandhi. So this is a little story. After seeing how mistreated Gandhi was by a man, one of his followers asked him if he had already forgiven him. Then Gandhi answered, I didn't forgive him because I didn't feel offended. So how enlightened is a person like that? He didn't need to forgive because it never hurted him. He knew that person probably had problems, was not good of mind, at least in that life. So he's like, it's okay. So for us it's so difficult, but for him it's so natural. So imperfect spiritists, us, like to say, I forgave, but God knows everything and sees everything, so sooner or later they will suffer the consequences of their bad actions. We cannot say that. This is not nice. We are here to learn. We are not supposed to say that. We already know the law of cause and effect. We don't need to say things like that. The good spiritists don't say that. The good spiritists will say, I forgave him because he's a sick person that needs my compassion and understanding. In addition, I know that that forgiving will free my heart from this ache. God is justice, so I don't need to worry. That's what we need to do. We keep thinking, oh, but you know, they don't have enough proof to put him in jail, this and that. In the past, I used to suffer like this because I think, my God, it is proven that this man did this and that and didn't go to jail. Don't worry about that. Maybe he didn't go to the justice of the man, but the justice of God, you know, it will prevent one day or other. It's not up to us to really be trying to find out. So we shouldn't bring problems home. This is a very common sentence, especially for people that love to fight. Oh, I don't want to bring problems home, so I'm going to decide it right now. No, 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 no. This is wrong, totally wrong. Because when we bring problems home, many times we have somebody in this house. And sometimes the good spirits will try to inspire that person to help us. So that person will say, what, my son, what's the problem? Oh, this. Oh, calm down, that person is not well. Or is a roommate, or is a friend. Or if we live alone, we will have time. We will have time to meditate, to calm down, to reflect. Our guardian angel will give good inspiration, and we will relax. So instead, if we decide the situation at that moment to fight, we are just going to create more problems instead of a help, or receiving help. So if we cannot forgive yet, we need to work harder on all those, and so many others. But those were some very important ones. Acquiring positive thoughts, occupying well our free time, searching for proper therapy. Yes, because sometimes it's so difficult. And we have that like a circle.
A vicious circle
that goes and comes. So proper therapy, they have special techniques that can really help us to cut this problem. So practicing meditation, that's another thing who helps so much. Total trust in God. This is absolutely important. And these two are especially stronger, because practicing charity is something that most of us that never did charity cannot really understand. Yeah, it's good, I see people doing. Oh, I see a lot of rich people doing. No, charity is not for the rich. Charity is for everybody. And you know, many times you say, oh, I have no money, I cannot help. Charity doesn't mean just material charity. Sometimes when we have that person that is a very difficult person, and the person is having a problem, and you take time to go and to talk and say, okay, how can I help you? This is also charity, because you're going over to a person that you have such a hard time. This is charity. And many times we don't even think about that. Talking about charity, this Sunday we are going to visit the nursing home. So any of you who would like to go with us, we have to be there at 3:00. So this Sunday we will be practicing charity. So, and work on our self-forgiveness, as I mentioned before. You know, sometimes we can forgive the other because we still didn't forgive ourselves. We will see this a little bit later. So now we're going to talk about practicing charity. So the Spirit's book, the question 886. Volunteers?
What is the true meaning of the word charity as Jesus understood it? Benevolence towards everyone, indulgence towards
the imperfections.
Of others to forgiveness for offenses.
Exactly. So we need benevolence, indulgence, and forgiveness. These are three things that help us so much. Do we practice all this? Most of the time, no. We have such a busy lives. We are always doing so much. We have to work. We have to go to school. We have to pick up kids in school. And many times we don't think about it. These are things that we really have to reflect and start doing a little bit. And we can do this all the time. All the time. This is a wonderful institution here in New York that feeds the homeless. And when you go there, actually Adilson have been there, I think other people from the center have been in this institution, and you go there, you can do all kinds of things. You can feed them, you can cook, you can clean, and it's so good because you are there giving love. We think that. We are there giving love, giving a smile. We are giving so much. Oh, we are so charitable. sometimes we are receiving so much more than what we are giving. Because we think we're giving so much, but in the reality, we are the ones who really need help. And when we are having a tough time in our lives, going to any kind of charity is so wonderful. There is no person that goes to an institution like this or many others. There are so many things that you can do. You can go to a hospital with kids of with cancer. You can donate clothes in the wintertime so the homeless come to pick it up. When you finish, you feel that love energy. You feel like you are so enlightened. So you really, something switch inside of you. You stop thinking about your problems. You see so many people in situations that are so worse than yours that you're like, my God, I'm so childish. How can I think about this when people are dying in the world? This is something to really reflect and act. And here is one picture of inner enlightenment in this nursing home we are going Sunday. Here's my son, Jensen. So he was singing, and we were sitting with the kids. This is a performance we do once a year. And we go there to bring smiles to them. So we sing, we dance, we act, we do all kinds of things to bring happiness. But when we leave, it's like we feel like we are Broadway actors. Because most of them are very weak. So it's not that they can clap and do so much, but the energy they send to you, it's immense, it's so powerful. The first time I went there, I did an act of dancing, and I was dancing, and I thought it was wonderful. When finished, nobody clapped. I was like, I finished, I walked, I'm like, oh my God, probably was awful, I can't believe. But then I had everything finished, so we started giving flowers to them. And then I started giving flowers, and I was giving a kiss. They were grabbing my hand, shaking. Thank you. And then I understood, I'm like, my God, I'm so stupid. They cannot, they have no energy to stand up and clap. They have no, and why do I need that? Because we are imperfect. And because I used to work in the theater and TV, I thought, we are imperfect. Grow up. What we receive maybe is not touchable, it's not plausible. You cannot see that. But the energy, and when you arrive to talk to them, they thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Oh, it was so wonderful. So this is so touching. I tell all of you, when you go to a place like that, a lot of people say, oh, I don't like to go to nursing homes. I just see death. Why you think like that? Why you have this mask on you to think like that? Many times we have to face things that are very painful. They are very difficult. And we do not want to think about that. But you have to change it. So you go there to bring love. You go there to bring happiness because you will receive it back. And they get so happy when they see us. It's like wonderful for all of us. And now, some sentences that really touch me. This, I commit myself to give myself back to myself. So this here, imagine a person that was happy, normal, had a great life, until something happened. And from that day, the person changed totally. The person became hard, negative, just could see bitter things. This is hard. And when we realize this, when we wake up and we understand, I need to go back to what I was before. I turned a horrible person. I don't want to be like that. So this is a workout inside of us to change and go back to what we were before. And then forgiveness is not something we do for other people. We do it for ourselves to get well and move on. This is important. That's the main thing of forgiveness. You know, forgiveness is something that's not just for spiritists. Forgiveness is for everybody, even people who have no religion, no understanding of anything. But if they understand, when they forgive, they feel better, it's so much easier. Nowadays, a lot of doctors are really doing studies because they found out many things. They found out positive people, happy people, and people that forgive has less diseases. So let's love more. Why we keep resentments and pain when we can smile and see life happier? I always talk about the bottle. Is the bottle half empty or half full? Depends on how people see it. I always see it half full because I try to be happier all the time. And I try to help others to see this too because this helps us. And now this is a video of a woman called Mary that she could have given this lecture here. Because the power of this woman is absolutely amazing.
We end tonight with one of the most potent powers on earth. It can change lives in an instant. Everyone has it. It's the power to forgive. Watch it now in action in Steve Hartman's A Silent America.
In a small apartment building in North Minneapolis, a 59-year-old teacher's aide sings praise to God for no seemingly apparent reason. Indeed, if anyone was to have issues with the Lord, it would be Mary Johnson.
For all you've done for me.
He never had a chance.
In February 1993, Mary's son, Loranian Bird, was shot to death during an argument at a party. He was 20 and Mary's only child.
My son was gone.
The killer was a 16-year-old kid named O'Shea Israel.
I wanted justice. He was an animal. He deserved to be caged.
And he was. Tried as an adult and sentenced to 25 and a half years, O'Shea served 17 before being recently released. He now lives back in the old neighborhood, close to Mary. This close.
He lives next door.
Next door.
How a convicted murderer ended up living a door jamb away from his victim's mother is a story not of horrible misfortune, as you might expect, but of remarkable mercy. A few years ago, Mary asked if she could meet O'Shea here at Minnesota's Stillwater State Prison. As a devout Christian, she felt compelled to see if there was some way, if somehow, she could forgive her son's killer.
What she said to you? I believe the first thing she said was, look, you don't know me, I don't know you, let's just start with right now. And I was befuddled myself.
O'Shea says they met regularly after that. When he got out, she introduced him to her landlord, who, with Mary's blessing, invited O'Shea to move into the building. Today, they don't just live close, they are close. Clearly, Mary was able to forgive.
Unforgiveness is like cancer. It will eat you from the inside out. It's not about that other person. Me forgiving him does not diminish what he's done. Yes, he murdered my son, but the forgiveness is for me. It's for me.
For O'Shea, it hasn't been that easy.
I haven't totally forgiven myself yet. I'm learning how to forgive myself, and I'm still going towards, you know, trying to forgive myself and what it is I've done.
To that end, O'Shea is now busy proving himself to himself. He works at a recycling plant by day and goes to college by night. He says he's determined to pay back Mary's clemency by contributing to society. In fact, he's already working on it, singing the praises of God and forgiveness at prisons, churches, to large audiences everywhere.
Forgiveness is a powerful thing.
Which explains why Mary can sing her praise of thanks to her audience of one. Steve Hartman, CBS News.
For all you've done for me.
So you see how powerful this video is and how difficult it was for her because he was sentenced 17 and a half years and only few years before he was released, she was able to go there and visit him and talk to him. Because it was very difficult. Can you imagine your baby, your child, your only child murdered? You cannot forgive this tomorrow. It's very hard. You need time. You need time to really digest this pain. But it's a pain that is necessary to be removed from inside of you. And doing this, she helped herself, yes, because she was able to free herself. She didn't keep this hatred for another life, resentment. And also she helped him, because when she helped him, he was able to find a home. He was able to get help to find a job. And she also taught him, now you have to praise the Lord. You have to talk about this to other people. So they go together. I saw many other interviews with both of them. They go together to churches to talk about it. So people get in disbelief how she can do it. She really embraced him as her son that she doesn't have anymore. He's in the spiritual realm, and now she has him. And he also goes to jail. He goes to jail to the inmates, and he talks about what he did. You know, impulse, 1 minute that you try to do something, maybe to scare the person, that's it. You took the life of a person. And then your life is marked to the rest of the life. So when we have this amazing power to forgive somebody, can you imagine how much forgiveness she's receiving, how much love she's receiving, her son, how much happy he must be? Because when we are in the spiritual realm, we are a little bit more, how can I say, our physical bodies allow, when we don't have the physical bodies, our spirit is free, and this allows us to think better. Because we are connected with all our reincarnations as one. So we are able to really understand it better. So her son is so happy that his mother didn't stay here alone in the situation of poor me, I'm terrible, or she went in depression, or maybe she went thinking about suicide because she's alone now. But no, this woman really did the most amazing forgiveness ever. So when we think about our little problems, our little forgiveness, let's feel ashamed and forgive immediately. Because yes, we can. Thank you.